changing one's Stalin's death, because totalitarianism without Stalin was dysfunctional even for those in power. That starts changing gradually, comes back, but that is it. The starting point. Okay, now let me start with three preliminary remarks. The one should be obvious, it's defensive, and explicative at the same time. I'm a political scientist. As a political scientist, I am forced, because that's the way I speak and think, not forced by the law. I employ political science jargon. Those of you who are deranged by it, or who think uncomfortable by it, think of the doctor who cannot diagnose in medical terms. Second, I want to draw your attention to two very recent, extremely recent events. One happened the day before yesterday, the one yesterday. The day before yesterday, Mr. Viktor Orban, or Orban Viktor, gave a speech in which he defined Miklós Horthy as a great personality and a great statement of Hungarian history. The second event, a speech delivered, I don't know where, but also yesterday, the day before yesterday, by the current rector of the CU University, and you're all familiar more or less with what happens with the CU in Orban, in which he said, Orban is not a fascist. He is a populist. The distinction is important. I'm going to use it in my way. And then now let me start. I'm forced here and there to read because I indulge in quotations. I couldn't use what others have said except for quoting them, because in biblical Hebrew, there is a saying, Omer B'Shem Omram. You have to attribute to whoever said what he said. We have left a happy Western and Eastern Europe in 1989. That would, in fact, continue. The really happy was 1991. Well, the Soviet Union dismantled. Yet back in 1994, one of our deans, historian, political scientist, Walter Bakker, warned against, I quote, the mistake to bury communism too early. There is a temptation, he said, to assume that like Lucifer, communism has fallen, never to come again. Yet, in one guise after the other, its heritage could be with us for a long time. Whether as left-wing or right-wing populism, is populism, he predicted, attempts might be made to restore it, or at least to salvage some of its major components. What is more, ladies and gentlemen, I finish this presentation, this is not the worst case scenario. Then I greatly admire, as a political science theorist who dealt with the common spirit, Ken Jowett, spoke about the extinction of Leninist regimes. And according to Jowett, this extinction created, quote unquote, a Genesis-like situation where chaos dominates. The international communist movement, and this is the one independent variable that in the thing that doesn't change, we thought, the international communist movement, for all it thought was an independent variable, Jowett writes, might be replaced by a dependent, unpredictable variable of movements of rage. The scenario was produced nearly a decade before the collapse of the Twin Towers in New York. Not that we lacked other scenarios. Following the initial euphoria epitomized by Francis Fukuyama's misplaced neo-Hegelianism, there were numerous variations of the "it's the economy, stupid." Paradoxically enough, just as deterministic in predicting a democratic institutional outcome as a result of privatization, as Marxists have been expecting the superstructure to reflect the socialized means of production. Yet no one has come up yet with an explanation, with a plausible explanation, for the fact that it was the former Yugoslavia, undoubtedly one of the most economically developed regions or former communist states that produce the bloodiest of all transitions, spawning four, if not more, full-scale wars. For accuracy's sake, one must mention that some transitologists, as we were called in sociologists, had to call themselves after the collapse of the Soviet Union, which makes me quote Ken Jowett again, that the only transition, successful transition, he is aware of is from problems of communism to general democracy. Okay. Transitologists were from the start more skeptical than others as to the primacy of the economy in particular and the one-way street to democratization in general. And I refer here to a book by O'Donnell and Schmitten, Transitions from Authoritarian Rule. But that book was written before communism fell, and never imagined that communism would fall. It refers to Spain, it refers to South America and to Greece. By the time more general comparative studies of transitions were launched, authors were making a clear distinction between, on one hand, complete democratic transitions, and on the other hand, consolidated democracies. That is, you could build a democracy and it would be very fragile. It's not a consolidated democracy. What was meant by consolidated democracy? Well, democracy is the only game in town in which it never occurs to anyone to play outside the formal rules. And now I'm jumping to the end of my. And now think, look at what happens in Hungary and in Poland nowadays. The only game now begins by changing the constitution so that it would allow the government to do whatever it wishes to do, including changing the role of the judiciary, in order to consolidate not democracy, but power. The two are not same. This is not tantamount to claiming that nothing of the importance change after 89. If the collapse of communism was produced by the cumulative effect of many faced crises of legitimization, Leslie Holmes argues, it should be reflected and affected, above all, the teleological capability of communism to serve as an external role model. You had to replace that. And what did you replace it with? Capitalism, of course. Capitalism that wouldn't take into account any of the basic negative traits that were right now at least since Marx. More, what this meant in practice is that communist successors' leaderships and their local competitors, regardless of their formal beliefs or allegiances, strove to distance themselves both domestically and internationally from the formal theological legitimation and produce a phenomenon called by Peter Evans institutional monotropic. What is institutional monotropic? You expect to copy the formal features of established democracy in the West, and the rest would be fine. It will follow by itself. But things didn't work that way. The empty room, left by the formal ideological legitimation, had to be filled by some new content. As Klaus Offi pointed out, I'm quoting, the social and political forces emerging in the aftermath of trade socialism could be envisaged as being split among three centers of gravity. Those whose referential point was positive history, in the sense that it was directed in some imaginary golden pre-communist past. Whatever existed before communism was golden. The second, those who, without necessarily seeking to redeem it, think as a political system, directed the affecting attachment to the better aspects of the communist past. Security, equality, and an authoritarian paternalistic protection offered by it. The party knows what it is doing, taking care of us. And finally, those belonging to the category seeking to achieve a better future through the emulation of Western-style democratic capitalism. And in between these three main things, you find all sorts of synthetic hybrids. And we thus come to the problems of legacies. Which legacies affect post-communist systems has been an issue under debate since shortly after the fall of the war regimes. Often pointed out that post-communist regimes are faced with a dilemma of simultaneity. Among them, a triple transition, a process having to go concomitantly with unconsolidated borders, because the old borders come to mind at least again, democratization, and property redistribution. To that dilemma, I modestly pointed out some time ago, one must add an additional one, though not triple, but nearly, quotation mark, double. What do you call positive legitimation from? From what does it stem? Can you, in other words, overcome the communist and authoritarian past without relying on an idealization of anti-communism? And under anti-communism, I include the worst anti-communists, the fascists. Herbert Kitchell, one of the most important contributors to this legacy dilemma, wondered along this line which legacies count in post-communism. Those produced by communism, or those produced by its previous era. And he distinguished between three main categories. One, which he called patrimonial communism, where one finds a reliance on a vertical change of personal dependence between leaders in the state and party apparatus and their entourage, buttressed by extensive patronage and clientelistic networks. In patrimonial communism, I quote from Mitchell again, political power is concentrated around a small clique of an individual ruler worshipped by a personality cult. In extreme cases, such regime give rise to sultanistic regime, to use a term which entered political science jargon sometimes ago. And that hinders someone progress. To sum up, we are dealing here with historical settings or a traditional authoritarian regime assisted by compliant religious leaders, rule of the societies of poor peasants, weak cities, a thin layer of ethnic pariah immigrant entrepreneurs, a small geographically concentrated industrial working class, and the corrupt coterie of administration dependent on the personal whims of the ruler. Which post-communist countries belong to this category? First of all, Russia. Then Bulgaria, Romania, Serbia, and Ukraine. As you may know this, with the exception of Ukraine, which is half-half, they are all Orthodox countries. Dominant religion is Orthodox. The second type of communism is what Kitchen called the national accommodative one. It includes regimes with more developed formal rational bureaucratic government structure that partially separated party rule and technical state administration. These regimes evidence a greater propensity to permit modest level of civil rights and elite contestation, at least episodically, while relying more on cooptation than repression as ways to install citizen compliance. One deals here with society that emerged from a semi-democratic and semi-authoritarian interwar politics, rather than with vibrant political mobilization around parties and interest groups. They had already undertaken significant steps towards industrial outcome of communist rule. But, I quote again, these states were settled with inefficient state bureaucracy, overstaffed by the offspring of the state-centered educated middle strata, unable to find work in private businesses. In these settings, urban-rural conflicts were particularly salient and congealed around intensive party divisions, while the industrial class conflict played a comparatively minor role in the crystallization of political divides. These are the states that include Czechoslovakia or afterwards Czech Republic, Poland and Hungary. And finally, the third category, what Kitchen calls bureaucratic authoritarian communism, where forces belonging to the opposition encountered a much harsher and more hostile climate than places as possible, in national accommodative communism, but for different reasons than in patrimonial communism. One deals here with a type of governance that came closest to the totalitarian model of a one-party state with all powerful, rule-guided bureaucratic machinery of government. And I will not further. According to Ketchum, there were two such post-communist ideas. One was the German Democratic Republic, and the other was part of the former Czechoslovak. Now, why do I think this is important? Because one would, at first sight, be tempted to attribute any negative post-evolution from the former democracy to the first category, namely to patrimonial communism. But look at the both. Patrimonial communism, all you have to strike out is communism. It was patrimonial, and it remains patrimonial. Not so in the authoritative legacy of communism, where it is not enough to strike out communism, and it's not really, it doesn't render the picture fully if you speak about authoritarianism. Because we are, ladies and gentlemen, we are dealing here with a reason, with a possible exception of Czechoslovakia. We had always authoritarianism. How do we explain that they some go back and try to install former legacy of authoritarianism, relying on democracy, and the others not? My answer is simple. Neo-populism. Why neo? Because unlike traditional populism, neo-populism relies on one main feature. It never calls back for the reinstitution of Marxism. Neo-populism is a denial of traditional populism, whether in its Russian form or in its Germanic form, Völkisch form. Neither is there. They are building on picturing a society in which the former communists had laid hands on the social means of production, and now they are corrupt to the bone, like Socialist Party in Poland, and made an agreement with Walesa, they bought Walesa, and they ruled the country. This is how they, and this is exactly how Mr. Orban started selling himself to the populace. Was there any basis of it? Of course it was. Socialist, post-socialist communism was just as corrupt as would become post-socialism and capitalism. That is, not corruption is the main feature. The main feature is a view of the state mechanism as a way to enrich ours. And ours means ours, those who belong to our food to our party. But you have to get rid of the others. And in order to get rid of the others, what do you do? What populists do everywhere. They place themselves in the position of being viewed as the leaders of anti-corruption. Leaders of anti-corruption in all senses of the word, including the personal one. I sacrifice myself for my nation. And when you look at it that way, then you all of a sudden realize that the category is much larger than just Hungary and Poland. In fact, you have the seeds of it also in Bulgaria, with this leadership of what is it here? The present. And you have seeds almost everywhere. Where are the differences, however, in the evolutions? The differences is what you rely on in order to get rid of the best and better. And here I come back to the indices. Many people want to forget that starting with the Nazis. No, I should start saying with Mussolini's fascists and to the Nazis and then to the different varieties of fascism. They all fought the evil of capitalism, including corruption. Of course, things developed in a different direction, and people have suffered in face of Auschwitz. How, why should you attach importance to the struggle against capitalism of the Nazis in face of fascism, the same? But that element never changed. The Iron Guard was born out of Romanian conditions and as disgusted with the corruption. So I see a time, but at no end do I see light. On one hand, a time which leads to neo-populism. The other end of time which leads to post-communist and fascism. And while I'm maybe too pessimistic, let me quote other two gentlemen of mine. Otherwise, one is the Bulgarian Ivan Krasev, who writes, I think, very exactly. East and Central Europe cannot be successfully viewed if openly admitted an anti-system ethos. That is why they are all against corrupting socialism or corrupting socialist thought. And Krasov adds, In present-day Eastern Europe, unlike in Europe of the 30s, there is no ideological alternative to democracy. The streets of Budapest and Warsaw today are flooded not by ruthless paramilitary formations in search of a final solution, but by restless consumers in search of a final sale. The dominance of consumerist society, which is named as itself often mentioned, which Tocqueville already saw that it means neglecting and leaving to the others that stupid leadership, might lead to what in turn Jacques Rupnik observed. Today's Eastern Europe populists, or rather neo-populists, are calling are not anti-democratic. Indeed, they claim to be the true voice of democracy, the people. They keep demanding new elections and referendum. They are not anti-democratic. They are anti-liberal. Illiberalism, illiberalism means precisely that, will make you happy, will have the capitalist system in place. We never intend to change it. But politics is something you shouldn't battle about. And we start with the judicial, with the constitution, and the judicial system. These are the two main trends that unite the Orban and Kaczynski regimes, and there is a third one, but I wouldn't